those who gazed into the heavens and said that we would never walk on the moon. Others who wondered why anyone would need a computer in their home. And the many who couldn't imagine a world not connected by wires. History is full of visionaries who encountered naysayers, doubters, and disbelievers. Those who sought out their own paths and followed their dreams. And while others stood still, they moved forward. Today there are those who believe that energy cannot be clean and affordable, that we cannot meet the needs of everyone, everywhere. But with conviction, invention, and perseverance, we can do amazing things. Our visions can be realized. Our problems can be solved. We can change the face of energy. We can change the world.
A very good morning to you all. Wow. What a thrill, what a pleasure. I have a very special gentleman to introduce to you, our Honorable Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger. He's been a visionary leader, somebody who's shaping the future of energy, not just for California, but for the whole world. Without his leadership, companies like Bloom will not be able to thrive. Bloom and all the new energy companies are eternally grateful to this gentleman who is a true pioneer in the land of pioneers. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, our governor, Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Well, thank you very much, K.R., for the nice introduction. And I love hanging out with this guy. Because I'm not the only one with an accent. You see what I'm saying? Love it. Another great immigrant story here. Anyway, I just want to say also welcome to Secretary George Shultz, who is George is sitting right over here. My very good friend, George. It's always great to see you. Especially since you're always trying to outdo me with your ties. So, I mean, it's great to see you. Let's give him a big hand. Being here today. And then, of course, another secretary and general, Colin Powell. Let's give him a big, big hand also. I'm a big fan also of Colin because I tell you why, because besides all the great work that he has done as Secretary of State and when he was in charge of the military and all this, but when I was the chairman of the President's Council on Physical Fitness, I asked him for support when we did the big workouts out in front of the White House. And he always came with his whole troops and everything and went around to all the exercise stations and really supported me. So I just want to say thank you so much for this great support that you've given me. You have been such a great friend. Thank you very much. We also have here Assemblyman Blakesley. Assemblyman Blakesley right here in the front. Let's give him a big hand. Then Assemblyman Beal. Assemblyman Beal, a big hand for Assemblyman Beal. And Mayor Chuck Reed. Where's Mayor Chuck Reed? Right here. Thank you. Now, this is not the first time I've been here at Bloom Energy because I was here in 2006 when it just was getting started. And I was here with Mayor Bloomberg, as a matter of fact, and I saw that it was then already a growing company and a company that's going to create a lot of action. As a matter of fact, at that time you had 10 manufacturing jobs. Now you have 200 manufacturing jobs, if I'm not mistaken, and I think you said that it's going to be this year, by end of this year, 350 manufacturing jobs. So let's give them a big hand for that great, great growth right there. Now, 160 years ago, thousands of gold rushers flocked to the West to risk failure and search of greatness. Now, of course, those brave souls all died in the meantime, but the spirit that they brought to the West, to California, is still alive, and we can see this with Bloom Energy. As a matter of fact, the spirit, the optimism, the daring has been the foundation of California. It's why we became the entertainment capital of the world, the high technology capital of the world, the biotechnology capital of the world, the aerospace capital of the world, and now the green technology capital of the world. Today we gather to celebrate the innovation and the bold vision of one of California's shining stars, which is Bloom Energy. Bloom's fuel cell technology, which you will hear more about very soon, has a potential to revolutionize the energy industry. It produces safe, reliable power that is 60% cleaner than a coal-fired power plant. 60% cleaner. And it produces that power on site. You don't need transmission lines. You don't have to put it on a grid or anything where, again, a lot of energy gets wasted. But you just have it right there at your building, at your office building or government building, whatever it is. In fact, this eBay campus here has been powered by 5 Bloom boxes since July. 5 of them. Now, the Wall Street Journal calls it today the mystery boxes, which is good. Keep it a mystery. Don't give it away. But those 500 kilowatt systems has already saved the company here $100,000 in just this few months. When people think of clean energy, they should think not just of solar or of geothermal or of hydro or wind or any of those things alone, but they also should think of Bloom Energy. So let me congratulate KR and the entire Bloom team for their work. Terrific work. Let's give them again a big, big hand for their great work. Now, here's the reason why California is leading the clean tech revolution. That is because we saw its awesome potential and we took action. We passed legislation, AB 32. Thank you. The Million Solar Roof Program, the Low Carbon Fuel Standard, Renewable Energy Standards, the Hydrogen Highway, and the list goes on and on. We are doing what government does best, passing laws and setting standards for the public good, and then get out of the way so that you can do what you do best. A wave of green innovation is washing all over the state of California. As a matter of fact, the Wall Street Journal calls it the new California gold rush. California attracts more clean venture capital than the rest of the nation. As a matter of fact, last year it was 57% of the venture capital came right here to California. And we're proving what's good for the environment is also good for the economy. Since 2005, green jobs in California have grown 10 times faster than other areas. When I visited Bloom in 2006, we saw, and I said earlier, it was a little company, but now it exploded, even in a recession. Even in a recession, it's the biggest recession since the Great Depression. This company is growing. And these are green jobs of the future, and we want that future, and we want those jobs right here in California. And that is why I am proposing a job package that includes a proposal to exempt the purchase of green technology manufacturing equipment from the sales tax. This would help businesses like Bloom expand and create jobs. And the day I call on the legislature once again and ask them to pass my job package so that we can go and create those jobs, not next month or next year, but right now. We need jobs, jobs, jobs right now. In closing, let me just once again congratulate Bloom Energy on its great, great success. This is a success that is now known all over the world. And so California is proud to claim you as one of our own. So now, please, ladies and gentlemen, welcome the founder and the CEO of Bloom Energy, KR. Please come up and say a few words.
Absolutely. The Bloom Energy of that.
Take some pictures that? In front of the
Bloom Energy, Energy box. Exactly.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for coming up. So, thank you, Governor. Isn't he wonderful? Inspirational. John Donahoe and the eBay team, thank you for being such gracious hosts today. And welcome to everyone. It's a very, very special day for us, and we're so glad you took the time to be here with us today. It means a lot to us. Our journey to here began millions of miles away on Mars. I was a professor at the University of Arizona, and I was trying to make Mars our second home, developing technologies so we can sustain life on Mars. Breathable air, water, heat, electricity, and fuels. If you had that, you can live anywhere. While I was working on that, the technology development was robust. Unfortunately, I couldn't say the same thing about the funding and the rockets, which I couldn't control. So it became an issue of impact, which is what I wanted to start this work on. After spending about a decade working on this, I had to look back. And I had to look back at our first home instead of our second home. While I was dreaming about Mars and Mars colonies, historically unprecedented things had happened on Earth. The few hundred million people that had stepped out of poverty and climbed the economic ladder around the world. And what did they all want? The same thing that we all want. More of everything. More resources. More water. More energy. And of course, they have a right to this. But we were trying to provide that in our old, unsustainable fashion. The unprecedented growth and demand simply said the ways of the past had to be changed, but we were not realizing that. It sent shivers down my spine as I thought about it. Why? If we just continued that way, we would be handing our children and their children a broken planet. Reminded me of the pale blue dot in the solar system that's called our only home. And the thought of handing our children and our grandchildren a broken planet and standing on the sidelines and complaining about it was not what I thought we should do. Just look at this picture. It's a composite image of World by Night. That's what it's called, composite image of World by Night. Each one of you will look at this picture and take your own messages. For me, it was really a composite image of two worlds, a bright world and a dark world. It was an image of the world of haves and the world of have-nots. It was an image of people who had the opportunity for economic growth and people who just were denied the opportunity to climb that economic ladder. No pathway to economic growth. 1 in 3 humans, 2 billion people, don't have access or affordable access to energy. The global population growth is expanding, and it's in that 2 billion population that it's growing faster than in the other part. Energy demands were exceeding, and without energy, they didn't have a passport to economic growth. My conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, was very simple. way before we have to confront the environmental issues associated with this, the geopolitical and social impact that that would have if we didn't change the way of doing business was a very big deal. That was not acceptable. You can't conserve your way out of this problem. You can't drill your way out of this problem. You can't mine and burn your way out of this problem. We simply had to find a different way. Some saw this as a big crisis barreling down. We saw this as a call to our generation, a call to our generation to make an impact that can do good and make good. What did the world need? Accessible, affordable energy that is sustainable. That's what the world needed. Well, other industries have handled this problem of access and affordability and done well. Why can't we simply follow examples of success? What are those industries? We in this room know this very well. Computing provided access in places that we would have never dreamed 20 years ago people would have computers. Same thing with telephones. You can go into a fishing village in Bangladesh, or you can go to the middle of Africa and find people walking around with a cell phone. Why? It's the wireless. It's going from centralized to distributed. That made a very big difference. But for it to virally spread, it needed to be distributed, but it also needed two things: reliable and affordable. If you had that, the world will adopt. The world will have access. Is that bar sufficient for energy? Was our first question. The answer came out, simply no. The bar is slightly higher. And that bar is clean. It also had to be clean. Now you go, Why clean? Is it because you're an environmentalist? Is it because you're an altruist? Is it because of regulation? The answer is no. When you take a power plant that's hundreds of miles away, putting out dirty emissions, and bring that power plant to your backyard, either the dirty emissions have to go or you have to go. So for energy to be distributed, it also had to be clean. Very simple. You put all these together, and it gave us a mission. That was our calling, to make clean, reliable energy, and the key word, affordable for everyone on the planet. That was the calling for our generation, and we at Bloom had to play a part in it, because we felt that it was our calling to play a part in this big equation. Typically in the Valley, companies are founded with a technology and a product, and then you look for what markets can I serve. This company was formed differently. We saw the big problem and we said, what is a product that can really meet this human need? We didn't have to start from square one. Electricity was invented either accidentally or by innovation a long time ago. We didn't even have to figure out that it needed to be affordable. People knew that a long time ago. You know, the need for backyard power to be clean, that's a centuries-old idea. We just have to go back to it. So, distributed for electricity. Thomas Edison had this idea 100 years ago. He was way before his times, way before his technology. So all this was out there. People had already thought about it. The fuel cell. Yes, folks, we did not invent the fuel cell. 1830s, it was there. What we needed to do was a very simple task. Take all these pieces of jigsaw puzzle, and weave them into one big coherent picture. What we needed to do is clean, affordable electricity that can be distributed and that's efficient, all together at the same time in the same place. That's what had not been done. We had to integrate these ideas into one single product. And that is what we have been at. And to do this, remember the affordable part being highlighted? We need to start with something simple. The core of our technology, everyone keeps asking, what's that magic sauce? What's that magic technology? Where does it go? Well, I think I'm going to disappoint you all. I'm simply going to tell you, the core of our technology simply is sand. Available in plenty in multiple continents, in ocean beaches. This sand, from this sand you get zirconium oxide, something that we use. Again, affordable, available in plenty. And it has a particular property, a scientific property, that allows us to make a fuel cell. Again, folks, 1980s patent. We didn't have to invent this. Credit to Walter Nernst. What we did with that, though, is we perfected the technology to create what I want to introduce to you, the Bloom Energy Fuel Cell. A flat piece of sand. Flat piece of sand, inexpensive materials, but this is the core of the technology. Well, fuel cells have been around for a long time, things have been done. What is all this about? Why is this so different? We take this material and convert it into this, starting with raw powders, with inexpensive manufacturing techniques. And we call that process powder to power. Powder to power for flat pieces of sand. And the uniqueness of this, here's what it is. There are many, but let me focus on the top four. First one is affordability, cost. Second one is the kind of fuels that we can use on this fuel cell. The third one is, we can both use it as an energy producing device, and we can use it as an energy storage device. And the last one is electrical performance and efficiency. Let me walk through each one of these for you because it's at the core of what we do. Again, as I went through, we make this out of sand, it's the cost. Affordable materials, you take that with mass manufacturing techniques that the semiconductor industry has invented a long time ago. We have no interest in reinventing the wheel. What you end up with is inexpensive materials. And we like that. More than us, our customers like that because they can have an affordable product. No precious metals, no corrosive acids, no molten metals. Unlike the legacy fuel cell technologies, flat piece of sand. The next is a very important attribute again, fuel flexibility. What goes in to the fuel cell? We can use a variety of fuels. It can be a traditional fuel, natural gas, propane, you name it. It can be a renewable fuel, landfill gas, biomass gas, ethanol, whatever you have. This fuel cell can take any of those fuels, and because of the unique chemistry of this cell, use that to produce electricity without the need for chemical plants that are complex that needs to process the fuel. The fuel cell itself does all that for us. That's the uniqueness of this fuel cell. How is that important to the customer? By giving them fuel flexibility, depending on what location they use this product, they can use the local fuel from there. That's a big deal. Secondly, if you have the choice of multiple fuels that you can switch at will, you can arbitrage to get the cheapest fuel going into your box and thereby get the best economics out of this box. That's how it's useful for the customer. The third attribute goes to something we call reversibility. Remember Mars? Taking solar electricity and producing fuels. Remember what we're doing here? Taking fuels and producing electricity. This box, this fuel cell, can do both. It can operate one way, and it can operate the other way. That's what we call reversibility. Why is this important? It's extremely important to us, I can tell you, because we have spent precious money patenting this technology worldwide. In a few years, how we will use it is to need help with the remote. Thank you. A home energy server of the future that simply has a solar panel and one of our Bloom home energy servers together will give you electricity day and night and also be able to charge your automobile. Your complete energy needs taken care of from that. You don't need the grid and you don't need a fuel infrastructure. Don't start signing up for orders yet. This is a product of the future. A decade or thereabouts is when you will see it. But this is a killer app, and we wanted to patent and protect everything. And this technology, we have proven, is capable of doing all that. Going back to our current product. Next slide, please. I think you skipped one. Energy conversion. So here, it's all about efficiency. We talked about what goes in the box. We talked about the fuel that needs to go in. Now let's talk about what's coming out. Compared to the US national grid, we're about twice as efficient. What does that mean? For the same amount of electricity that you need to consume, you need half the fuel. So your carbon footprint, if you're going with traditional fuels, is about half. And like the eBay campus, if you use a renewable fuel, you're carbon neutral. Use all the electricity you want, and don't feel guilty about polluting the environment, because you're not. Isn't that wonderful? And by the way, that renewable electricity is 24/7, 365. This is not when the sun shines. This is not when the wind blows. This is a base load, all-time working fuel cell. In simple ways, that's how this little piece of sand is very different from what's been done before. So to summarize, lower cost, use of fuels, the reversible nature of what we do, and a very high efficiency, all leading to better economics, better carbon footprint. That is the Bloom fuel cell. How do we then take that and build it into a product? This particular device, way back, John, you remember, Vinod, you remember, 5 watts. There's a Moore's Law equivalent. I don't know what that is yet. We will tell you in a few years. Today, it produces 25 watts, enough for a light bulb. 2 years from now, stay tuned. Okay? So you take a bunch of these together and you put them together in what we call a stack. Think of this as the chip in your computer. If this were the microprocessor in your computer, this would power an average US home. 24/7, 365, all your energy needs, average US home. So you take a bunch of these stacks, put them together in a box about the size of a refrigerator, and that's enough to power a small Starbucks coffee shop. You take four of those 25 kilowatts together and put them in a box, affectionately called the Bloom box now, about the size of a parking lot. We would prefer you call it the Bloom Energy Server. About the size of a parking space. And that can power a small supermarket. You need more power? You do exactly what you do in a data center. You have multiple servers, and as your computing need increases, you keep adding the servers. You just cluster them. You just cluster our boxes to add to the power that you need to meet your energy needs. Modular, pay as you grow, buy as you grow model. So, if I just stopped at this part of the presentation, which is what I could have done a few years ago if we were introducing this company, and left it here. Think about what all of you will be thinking. Here is KR wanting to play in a sandbox, building his sandcastles in the air. Right? We had a gate. We had an ethical and a moral obligation not to talk about something this difficult, this risky, that so many people have tried before, until we had proof points. Those proof points are called products and customers. And until that happened, it was not right for us to be speaking to you and telling you what we do. It took 8 years and over 400 million cumulative hours of making, breaking, improving, testing this fuel cell to get it to the point where we need to get it. Get the early units out to the customer. Have it tested. Prove that the product is capable of doing what it needed to do. And this is a day I've been looking forward for a very long time, along with my family, the entire Bloom employees and their families, and especially our investors. So it is with great pride on their behalf, the entire Bloom family's behalf, I would like to introduce to you the Bloom Energy Server. Let me indulge you and say, it's my baby, isn't she beautiful? We just wanted it to be industrial art. We didn't want it to be something you hide out back. We just wanted you to display it proudly, because this is the future of energy. So, the important thing is what you don't see. Doesn't have big moving parts making clunky noises. You don't have a chimney spewing out smoke. You don't have something hot and hot, danger, don't touch it. You don't have vents. You don't have industrial green industrial equipment. You don't have Frankenstein heat devices. It's an all-electric plug-and-play future of electricity. There are 5 of these units powering this building and this campus right here at eBay, and you will get to see it after this talk. Why did they buy this? I'm sure not because it's beautiful. I'm sure that's what, you know, that's a nice thing to have, but that's not the selling point. There are 3 major value propositions among the many value propositions that we bring to our customers. And the 3 are, the first is lower energy costs. 3 to 5 year payback period on the box. And more importantly for businesses, the predictability that they have control on the electricity price for the next 10 years. That is extremely important for business. That's number one. The second one is carbon footprint. With fossil fuels, you can reduce it by about a half. With renewable fuels, you can reduce your carbon footprint by about 0. The third attribute, 24/7/365. And we have a modular redundant architecture with hot swappable technology. Very similar to if a server were to break in a data center, it doesn't take your data center down. Similarly, if any one unit has to be serviced out here, the customer is not going to be out of power. That's a big deal for businesses. So when you offer somebody reliability, lower carbon footprint, and by the way, it saves you money. That's a value proposition. This is what our customers look for, and this is what they like. In the very short period since we put our first units up, we have put enough units in our customer sites, the equivalent of which is about 1,000 homes being powered for over a year. Not bad in a very short amount of time for a new technology. And we're extremely proud that in that process of generating that much electricity, we have offset enough carbon. It is the equivalent of planting 1 million new trees. Today, we're extremely proud to announce a select group of our foundation customers. Customers are the foundation of any business. Our business is to serve you. These are leaders, leaders in their verticals, leaders who are early adopters, leaders who want the double advantage of both a good carbon bottom line and an economic bottom line, not either or. You've been early adopters and wonderful to us. It's with great gratitude that I want to say thank you to all of you. And they're going to come up and speak about it, because the proof is in the pudding, and that's why we waited this long. And we're going to have a customer panel right now. But before they come on board, I want to introduce John Doerr, who will be the panel moderator. In October of 2001, I approached Kleiner Perkins with this idea. I went to a meeting in their offices on Sand Hill Road, met with John, Vinod, and Aileen Lee. She's somewhere in the audience. There. So, it was after the dot-com boom and bust, or however you would like to call it, John. Kleiner wasn't investing in energy at that point. We were the first energy investment. Put this vision out of what we needed to do. And the visionaries that they are, they got this instantly and said, let's go build a great company. it's been a great ride since then. They've been phenomenal partners. The entire partnership has embraced us and done what they needed to do. And every following investor that came along has done exactly that. We're just privileged, honored to have that group of investors. John, in those 8 years, has become a mentor, friend, therapist, all of the above, board member, all of the above. But it is his passion to think big, to just take on whatever comes, and this desire to be number one. That rubs off on you real fast. So John, thank you for everything you've done. Ladies and gentlemen, John Doerr.
Good job.
Thanks for watching The Auto Channel. For more great automotive information and entertainment, visit theautochannel.com, the internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive information resource.